Good morning, students. Today we shall discuss about the advantages and disadvantages of different types of compensating equipment for transmission system, and also we shall discuss the fundamental transmission line equation and also the surge impedance. Okay, in last class we have discussed about the fundamental requirements of a transmission line, of a transmission system. So this is the second module of reactive power subject. Okay, reactive power control in electric power system. What are the first we shall see the different types of a compensating equipment, that is the switched shunt reactor and switched shunt capacitor, and next is a here they use a synchronous condenser also. Switched shunt capacitor, switched shunt reactor, and next is a series capacitor, and also here synchronous condenser. Next is a each type advantages and disadvantages we shall discuss. Okay, polyphase saturated reactor. Polyphase saturated reactor. And next, thyristor controlled reactor, thyristor switched reactor. These are the types of compensating devices. One by one, we shall discuss the advantages and disadvantages. Okay. First, switched shunt reactor. The advantages is simple in principle and construction. And what about the disadvantage? Here, this is a fixed in value. Next is switched shunt capacitor. Simple in construction and principle. Next is disadvantage is fixed in value and switching transients. Series capacitor, simple in principle and performance is insensitive to location. And what about the disadvantages of series capacitor? It requires overvoltage and protection and subharmonic filters and limited overall, that is overload capability. So one by one we shall discuss in detail in the next modules. Okay, series capacitor is a one unit you'll read in detail. Even series synchronous condenser and thyristor controlled reactor, thyristor switched capacitor, in detail we shall read in the further classes. Okay, so now just you should know the advantages and disadvantages. The synchronous condenser advantages is overload capability, full controllable, low harmonics. And what about the disadvantage? High maintenance requirements, low response, performance sensitive to location, and it requires a strong foundation. Next is a polyphase saturated reactor. What about the advantages of polyphase saturated reactor? It is a rugged construction and large overload capability, no effect on fault level, and also the low harmonics. What about the disadvantages? It is essentially fixed in value and performance, and it is a sensitive to location, and it is a very noisy. Okay, now what about the thyristor controlled reactor? Advantages is fast response, fully controllable, and no effect on fault level, can be rapidly repaired after failure also. Disadvantage is it is a thyristor controlled reactor. It will generate the harmonics and it is very sensitive to location. The thyristor switched reactor can rapidly repair after failures, no harmonics, and disadvantage is absorbing and capability to limit, no inherent absorbing and capability to limit. Over voltages, to limit our over voltages, and it is a complex bus work and control, low frequency response with the system, and performance sensitive to location. Next topic is the fundamental transmission line equation. Here this equation indicates the variation or variation of voltage and current is sinusoidal, or we can say it is a variation of voltage and current. This equation indicates that variation of voltage and current is sinusoidal. The fundamental equation governing the propagation of energy along the transmission line is the wave equation. This is the wave equation d square v divided by dx square is equal to gamma square into v, with gamma square is equal to r plus j omega l into g plus j omega c. Here we assume that frequency is fixed and the v is the phasor voltage, that is v vector e to the power of j omega t divided by square root of 2 at any point on the line. Okay, next solution for the transmission line wave equation for the standard waves. Okay, standing waves, if we assume that the line is a lossless, okay, then the general equation, the general solution of equation 1, v of x and I of x, what we can write? V of x is equal to vr cos beta a minus x plus j z naught into ir sin beta a minus x. And what about the I of x? Usually we write the v divided by r. That is what? Vr divided by z naught sin beta a minus x plus ir cos beta a minus x. We have written the line is assumed lossless, and that we have written the solution of equation 1 in terms of v of x and I of x. Okay, I have already told the equation 1 indicates the variation of voltage and the current in sinusoidal. And that is where beta is derived from the propagation constant gamma. This symbol indicates the gamma, okay? By putting r is equal to g is equal to 0. If we substitute r is equal to g is equal to 0 in the gamma equation, so you will get the gamma is equal to j into beta. Beta is equal to what? Beta is equal to omega into square root of LC, okay? This is the figure circuit, transmission line circuit, that is lumped element representation of a long transmission line. V and I are said to form a standing wave because of the sinusoidal variation of both real and imaginary parts along the line. So the quantity 1 divided by square root of LC is the propagation velocity of the electromagnetic effect on the line. What we say that V and I are standing waves because of the sinusoidal variation of both real and imaginary parts along the line. The quantity which is 1 divided by square root of LC is nothing but it is a propagation velocity of the electromagnetic effect. And since what usually we write omega is equal to 2 pi f, but here beta is equal to what? Beta is equal to 2 pi f divided by u of v, because that is nothing but here 2 pi divided by lambda is there. Lambda is equal to v divided by f. Okay, actually it is v divided by f. Okay, v by lambda is equal to v by f. Lambda is equal to v by v is nothing but velocity. Okay, that is what? 2 pi f divided by u, r is equal to 2 pi divided by lambda. Okay, lambda is nothing but a wavelength. Lambda is nothing but wavelength, and beta is the wave number and the number of complete waves per unit of line length. This is about the fundamental transmission line equation. Okay, next we shall discuss about the surge impedance and natural loading. Well, surge impedance, it is also called as characteristic impedance. They may ask in the questions in the exam, explain about the characteristic impedance instead of explain about the surge impedance or natural loading. Okay, you should know what is a surge impedance called as. Okay, surge impedance is called as characteristic impedance. Z naught is equal to square root of 1 L by C. This is the standard equation for the surge impedance, right? Here, sometimes we called as a characteristic impedance. It depends upon the line design. Okay, one thing you need to remember, the formula Z naught is equal to square root of L by C, and it is called as a characteristic impedance, and it mainly depends on the line design. Okay, for high voltage, that is the overhead lines, the positive sequence value in the range is 200 to 400 ohm. Okay, the positive sequence value type, it lies in the range of 200 to 400 ohm for higher voltage. Okay, for higher voltage overhead lines, if we consider, that is, well, if we neglect the losses, then the line is characterized entirely by its length and the two parameters. Okay, firstly you need to remember the formula, and it is called as characteristic impedance, and it depends on the line design, and for higher voltage the value lies in the 200 to 400, and if we assume that, or if losses are neglected, then the line is characterized by three parameters. One is line, and the two parameters, that is Z naught and beta. Okay, since these values are roughly comparable for all lines, okay, this Z naught and beta value is roughly comparable for all lines because the behavior of all lines is the same. Okay, the only difference arises according to the length, the voltage, and the level of power transmission. The surge impedance is the apparent impedance. What they are saying is the surge impedance is nothing but a apparent impedance of an infinite long line, that is the ratio of the voltage to current at any point along it. A line of finite length, that is a, which we have considered, is a infinite line, infinite long line. For that they are saying the surge impedance is equal to voltage divided by the current. Okay, a line of a finite length terminated at one end by an impedance, that is Z naught, is electrically different from an infinite line. Okay, finite length is different from infinite line, right? So that if V R divided by I R is equal to Z naught, then the equation of V of X and I of X, the apparent impedance at any point, is Z of X is equal to V of X divided by I of X. Substitute the value, that is V of X equation and I of X equation, that is equals to Z naught, because here, which is a independent of X. Okay, more importantly, this is a independent of X. So V of X is equal to VR cos beta. They have written in terms of VR cos beta A minus X plus J sine beta A minus X. They have taken common. Instead of here, we can write in terms of the e to the power of j beta a minus x. E to the power of theta, that is e to the power of j theta, if it is there. So we will write in terms of cos plus j sine theta, right? I of x is equal to, similarly you need to write for current, I of x is equal to IR cos beta into a to the power of, cos beta a minus x plus j sine beta a minus x. If e to the power of theta, we write the cos theta plus j sine theta. Okay, like that only we have written in terms of e to the power, that is IR e to the power of j beta a minus x. That is, V and I have a constant amplitude along the line. The line is said to have a flat voltage profile, that is V and I are in phase with each other all along the line. Both are rotated in phase. The phase angle between the sending and the receiving end quantities is, that is, theta is equal to beta into A. Here we can see the phasor diagram of naturally loaded line. ES and V, ES and V, ES or VS or ER and VR. Okay, the difference between here is the angle theta. In order to get the flat voltage profile, a line in this condition is said to be a natural loaded. That is, natural loaded is our surge impedance loading. Surge impedance loading is V naught is equal to V naught square divided by Z naught. V naught is nothing but a nominal or weighted voltage of the line. And here, if the V naught is the line to neutral voltage, then this equation will give the per phase value of the surge impedance power. Okay, if V naught is the line to neutral voltage. Okay. If V naught is a line to neutral voltage, what the output, what the per phase value of the surge impedance power you'll get, per phase value of the surge impedance power you'll get. If V naught is line to line, okay, one thing, two consideration here. If V naught is line to neutral and V naught is line to line, okay. If V naught is line to neutral voltage, you'll get the per phase value of a surge impedance power, okay. And if we use a line to line voltage, then you'll get the three phase value, right? An advantage of operating the line at the natural load is that because of the flat voltage profile, the insulation is uniformly stressed at all points. What is the advantage if we use a natural loading means? If we use that, we can achieve the flat voltage profile, and here is the insulation is uniformly distributed. It is not more at the sending end side or at the receiving end side, or stress is not at the receiving end side and the sending end side. It is a uniformly distributed, okay, uniformly stressed at all points. The natural load of the uncompensated line increases with the square of the voltage. The natural load, the natural load of the uncompensated line increases with the square of the voltage. This helps to explain why transmission voltages have increased as the level of transmitted power has grown. Okay. If you increase the voltage, then automatically the level of transmitted power has increased. Okay, the surge impedance Z naught is a real number. Therefore, at the natural load, the power factor, that is cosine of the angle between V and I, is unity at all points along the line, including the ends. That is this is a apparent for equation 2. This means that at natural load, no reactive power has to be observed or generated. At natural load, we don't require any compensating device because it will be the unity power factor, and the no reactive power has to be observed or generated at either end, either it is a sending end side or receiving end side, to balance the system or to maintain the stability. The reactive power generated in the shunt capacitance, of the line is exactly observed by the series inductance. The capacitance you can observe in the line, the capacitance in the parallel. That means you can observe the capacitance will be like this, right? It is connected in the parallel. So the series is, the series have an inductance like this, right? So the reactive power generated by this shunt capacitance of the line is exactly observed by the series inductance. If any short element of the line reactive power per unit length generated by the shunt capacitance, that is V square B is equal to V square omega C, while the reactive power per unit length observed by the series inductance is, this is which is generated and this is which is observed inductance, okay, I square omega L. For reactive power balance in the element of the line, so V square omega C is equal to I square omega L. That is, V divided by I is equal to square root of L by C, that is equal to Z naught. This must be true at all along the line, including the sending and the receiving end. Therefore, reactive power balance is achieved at the natural loading, that is, with P naught is equal to V square divided by Z naught. This is only the value of transmitted power that gives a flat voltage profile and unity power factor at both ends of the line. If we use a natural loading, it will achieve the flat voltage profile and it gives a unity power factor at both the ends of the line. In the sense that P naught is the natural power of the line, the natural reactive power is zero. This is regarding the surge impedance and the natural loading. Okay, in next class we shall discuss the uncompensated line on open circuit, that is voltage and current profile.